3 years ago, at the start of the 2007 school year, more than 800 children in Prince George's County, Maryland, were barred from attending school, and their parents were threatened with fines and jail time. Why did this happen? Because the parents had failed to produce the required documentation that the children had received the series of immunizations required for school attendance under state law. The action led to angry public confrontations between parents and the officials charged with enforcing the law. Compulsory vaccination laws are among the most effective, efficient, and beneficial of all public health interventions. They've been responsible for enormous reductions in sickness, death, suffering, and economic costs. They also can be very inflammatory, not only to a persistent minority of parents who believe that vaccines cause autism and other health problems, but also to parents who are simply angry at what they perceive as the coercive, heavy hand of government. Officials in Maryland might have been interested to hear the opinion of a health commissioner in New York who said the following. He said, "I would rather have the sentiment of the community strongly supporting health authorities without legislation than compulsory legislation and an antagonistic public sentiment." This comment was not a response to the events of 2007. It was made in 1915 in response to an almost identical series of events taking place in several communities in upstate New York. The use of compulsory vaccination has been haunted by the specter of public backlash ever since Massachusetts became the first state in 1855 to make public education contingent on vaccination against smallpox. Public health professionals approaching a situation like the one in Prince George's County, Maryland, want to decide, above all, what can be done to secure the cooperation of the parents and the vaccination of the children. But they are also interested in, or at least they should be interested in, a whole set of broader and more complicated questions, questions that are deeply historical. What social, political, cultural, and economic forces give rise to these episodes? Why have compulsory vaccination laws been relatively well accepted in some regions and in some eras and bitterly resisted in others? What rhetoric and strategies have supporters and opponents of vaccine mandates used? What have been the consequences, both intended and unintended, of the actions taken on both sides of these debates? How does the experience of the U.S. differ from that of other industrialized democracies? And how is it that the U.S., with its strong traditions of limited government, uses compulsory vaccination far more extensively than almost any other country in the world? These questions are, of course, of more than just academic interest, and they carry special urgency in 2010. At this moment, California is experiencing its worst outbreak of whooping cough in decades. 2 years ago, outbreaks of measles swept through communities across the United States, the spread of disease often fueled by pockets of unimmunized children whose parents had declined to have them vaccinated by taking advantage of the opt-out provisions that most state vaccination laws provide. Over the past decade, more than a dozen states have either changed their laws or considered legislation to make it easier for parents to opt out of school vaccination requirements. And many health officials have grown concerned that permissive opt-out provisions have the potential to undermine high levels of vaccine coverage that have been achieved in school-age youth. Surveys suggest that relatively small numbers of parents are exempted from vaccine requirements. Children are exempted from vaccine requirements by their parents, generally only about 1 to 2% of children. These numbers might suggest that exemptions are an acceptable compromise that diffuses the risk of community backlash without endangering the safety of children or the community. The problem is that exemptions tend not to be randomly distributed throughout the community. They tend to cluster. There are some regions of the country, including the Puget Sound area, the area around Boulder, Colorado, some rural communities in Northern California that are well known for having high opt-out rates. In a few communities, opt-out rates as high as 15% have been found. Research has shown that schools with exemption rates as low as 2 to 4% are at heightened risk of disease outbreaks, and that children who have been exempted from vaccine requirements have a much greater risk of acquiring infectious diseases than their non-vaccinated peers. The implications of history for current policy are rarely straightforward, and the history of legally enforced vaccination is sufficiently long and complex that one might draw a variety of conclusions, some mutually contradictory, about the best course of action for today as health officials grapple with the issue of the increasing number of vaccine exemptions. Popular resistance to vaccination in general, and to compulsory vaccination in particular, has waxed and waned over the past two centuries. It was especially prominent during the first two decades of the 20th century, when the role of science in public policy was a hotly contested issue. It became dormant in the middle decades of the century as the medical profession gained status and authority. Some of the attitudes and beliefs that have underpinned opposition to compulsory vaccination have remained remarkably consistent and durable, however. These include suspicion of scientific elites, and as a corollary, the belief that medical experts and pharmaceutical companies are simply motivated by profit and can't be trusted to act in the best interests of the public. Belief in natural or alternative healing methods has been a very important strain in these events, and the belief that compulsory health laws of any kind violate the country's foundational values of individual liberty and freedom from government restraint. Any public health response to the issue of immunization must take into account the underlying forces that are animate challenges to the authority of health officials. The issue of compulsory vaccination is an example, a specific example, of a much broader and more general challenge in public health policy and practice. What is the most effective and ethical way of using the law to advance health? Since the sanitary revolution of the 19th century, law and regulation have been among the most powerful tools for securing the health of the public. The first public health crusaders, working with state and local governments, established regulations over such diverse aspects of civic life as the production and distribution of meat and milk, tenement construction, garbage collection, so-called noxious trades like slaughterhouses and tanneries, and public and private privies. But these efforts have also been among the most contentious in the history of American public health. Controversies have emerged in areas as diverse as the fluoridation of water supplies, isolation and quarantine of people with infectious diseases, directly observed therapy for tuberculosis, and mandatory motorcycle, helmet, and seatbelt laws. The aggressive use of law, though often effective, has critics across the political spectrum, from civil libertarians on the left, who are fiercely protective of the rights of individual liberty and privacy, to free market conservatives on the right, who are hostile to infringements on commercial and property interests. These critics have raised profound ethical questions about the balance between the rights of the individual and the welfare and the safety of the community. People who are worried about the threat of government overreaching in the name of health sometimes invoke history by quoting an infamous Supreme Court decision from 1927, in which Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes upheld a Virginia law allowing the forced sterilization of a woman judged to be feeble-minded. In that decision, Holmes wrote, "The principle that sustains compulsory vaccination is broad enough to cover cutting the fallopian tubes. Three generations of imbeciles are enough." Yes, Oliver Wendell Holmes really did write that. Compulsory sterilization laws, though they seem abhorrent to us today, were considered by some reputable figures in the 1920s to be advancing a legitimate public health purpose. Now, I certainly don't mean to suggest here that I think one day future historians might regard compulsory vaccination the way we now think of compulsory sterilization. Rather, I'd like to suggest that one of the benefits of studying history is to guard against hubris. It's to help us remember that public health judgment is not infallible, that the use of compulsory public health measures has a somewhat checkered past, and that it is a mistake to simply dismiss those who disagree with our efforts as kooks and cranks. Whether compulsory vaccination is an effective and appropriate way to control the threat of infectious disease is partly an empirical question that should be answered by people with expertise in medicine and epidemiology. But it's not only an empirical question. It also implicates deeply held philosophical beliefs about the relationships among the individual, civil society, and government. The study of history can give us a more nuanced understanding of these issues to guide our decision making. Debates over vaccination and all public health interventions must be understood in more than technocratic terms. What history can do, as distinct from the other disciplines of public health, is to situate these questions within the larger context of where the country has been and where we are heading. Thank you.